always keep to the timeline. That's good. So, thank you for the possibility to presenting. It's always hard to have the first presentation after lunchtime, so nobody's there. I like that because then I have a less of questions. No, no. Of course, please feel free to question everything. I have a topic I think that is very questionable. And I know that I'm setting myself into fire if I discuss these things. Yeah? The point is, can you do a little bit more light? A little bit more that I see my audience, even if there's just some few guys. The major point is, we are all doing that lean and lean construction, the efforts and all the things for what? For value of the customer. So please tell me, what is value for the customer? I'm a client. I'm working for BMW. Yeah? In the construction department. I'm only looking for our value. But I can't tell you exactly what this value is about. And that's a problem for me. Because if I can't tell the people, we all have a problem because even you can't know if I don't know. So we looked for something. So just to know, Stefan was my master student. He wrote around this topic and he did a very good master thesis in theory with that. And Sherwin was also admitting and as a professor giving us advisory. So it was a very good work together. We have two simulations in BMW. We have a lean design simulation and we have a lean construction simulation. Both simulations are there for training. What we show there is how they can implement lean construction in their project. We have always different roles there. The different roles show normally the planners here, the client as well, as some interface connections, and here the construction team with the project manager and the client as well. What happens is always the client changes something in the process of doing work. What is normal? It's always like that. But they never look for that. But what started is, what I see there is every time they get frustrated in the team. So playing a role brings you to a normal acting at one point, if you're under pressure. So you can see that they feel that the customer, the client, if he changes something, he gets an enemy. First they want to serve him, in the end they want to kill him. Not really, but... So it happens that they pushed him away from the board or from the simulation just to do not get the next change. So, and therefore it was clear for me. It was absolutely clear what the product value was for the customer. It was communicated at the start, absolutely. What we get is there should be something in the process that is not clear, demanded, and directed, and designed to say, this is a value for the customer, and how we can connect that to this value as a construction team. So I think everybody is on the same page if I said, value for the customer is one of the big things in lean construction. Nobody knows what that is, but it is a big thing. Everybody is telling you, well, we do that for God. Yeah? Say, who is that? Yeah? Well, the value for the customer. But you can't really grab it. So what we identify for ourselves is a kind of system where we see all the relationships. And I talked to Chris in the evening in the wharf, where he said, everyone is a customer. He said, yes, everybody is a customer. Of course, in the process. But there is one ultimate customer, maybe, yeah? What we then, in the end, decide to make, yeah, that's the ultimate customer, because he is, in the end, responsible for the money, and really, this is, he wished something, he needs something from the whole process. What we had is, this is our ultimate customer. So you have a lot of relationships between suppliers, contractors, subcontractors, general contractors, designers, and more. But in this customer as well, you have different kind of relationships. That's not one customer in a big company. There are a lot of people speaking. There's a lot of politics going on. How can you describe that and determine that even for the customer to get a stable flow in the process? That's what we're looking for. So we have to define who is the customer and what is the value. So we go through research and we saw that there are some definitions and we can see that there's a lack of information around this value. Bertelsen told it, it's the biggest weakness that we do not know it. What is it? It's, huh? Again, here? There was no accepted definition for the construction industry as the customer value is. Yeah? Koskela also mentioned it's not a lot of non-value adding work. But what is that if I can't count that to the value of the customer? So what we had is there is a need for a conceptual thinking around that. So we do not show what we normally do in the construction companies and said, let's invent something. We look to other industries, marketing, psychology, all the things they really run that things. And there were three different types of models they use for getting these customer value by processes. It's not the product thing, but it's a problem in the end. It's the process between to get to the product. So we came to component models, relationship models, and means-end models. What that means is component models just show the different components, and they bring them into relationship with a customer. We try to make a kind of sheet, short sheet, to clarify that the different models give a B2C or a B2B connection. So of course, they have maybe to the customer, not but to the business. That means everybody's a customer, that's business to business. Yeah? Business to, yeah, see, you have their one ultimate customer. So both has to work in that model. So we see that we are really limited in this B2C thing here, and here in the B2C. B2B in the processes, you can see that in the processes, there and there, we are limited in these systems. I don't want to go too deep in these systems because it's not where we go for. The second one is the relationship model. The relationship model shows you, yeah, you can do that here, but even there in the processes, they are limited or weak of doing it and showing the processes in the value. The relationship models bring different values into relationship between each other and then to the customer. So you can make it relative, this value to this value. That sometimes helps. The third thing was a means-end models. That means we have means and ends. Ends are the products. Means are the things what you really need to gain the process. So there is something incoherent in it. These models give you the possibility to look through the process, not leaving the product value in the end. So how they are structured? They are structured as goals, consequences, and attributes. Goals are the goals what the customer needs in the end or during the process. Consequences are things they coming out of these needs. They just part of the physical or theoretical construction process. And attributes is how we fulfill these consequences. So you in the end, you can't do something here to fulfill the goals. You can just fulfill the consequences, and then in the end, you get to the goals in the ongoing process. So if we go through the process, the point is we start with the goals. The goals of the customer starts here. From that, from these goals, means I need a production line. You never mention a building. I need a production line. If you can do it in a tent, the same, well, we do it in a tent or in a cave. What else? Yeah? But in that is construction the best thing to do it. So it means we need a hall, industrial hall. That's a need. This need has some requirements. You have to do a design, you have to do a construction, you have to do a layout. Yeah? And all these things come into a design, planning, construction, where the interaction is. And out of that, you have a building usage, where they really the value starts for the customer. And in the end, and that's what we are getting is from our, as in the end, they are really fulfilling the goals. After the cycle in the industry hall, they fulfill the goals. So how does this means-end model looks like? The goals, we divided into two different things, hard needs, soft needs, and for the fulfillment, the conditions, duties, and surroundings. What we get is by putting all the things in, what we need was, well, there are things where the customer normally don't want to do it, but forced to do it. What could that be? Safety. That's my construction site. I have to be responsible for every issue on my construction site. It's my land, my country, my surface, my ground. I have to prepare the ground that the construction companies can start. Thank you. So this is not just the needs, what they have for themselves, for their goals. There's also some requirements and conditions they have to fulfill. But they are also part of the value for the customer. Because if you don't use them or fulfill them, you will never get to the goals. So you can see, we just rated hard here, saying cost, scheduling, time, quality, flexible decision making, cooperation, communication, soft, hard things. Yeah? And then the needs, that could be also shifting around in different countries and different facilities, but controlling, coordination, documentation, all the things, what you have to do in a normal construction process. It is also part of the value for the customer. So go one step deeper. Consequences. Consequences, we have structured them and we asked it more than 50 different construction clients. In a paper, it's not mentioned in that paper, but we asked them to get to these consequences. So there were information, you have to inform the whole project. Project structure, a team, how you build the team of, and construction processes as you adapt it or plan it. It could be more, could be less. But what you bring into is, these are the consequences out of the goals. If the goals changes, you change the consequences. If the consequences do not tell you exactly how to do it, it tells you just, there's something, look for it. If you find another point to put the consequence out and put something in, you can do that without changing the goals. Like security, order, cleanliness. And then the attributes. The attributes are the worker level, where they have to do it and how they do it. How they get the things, the consequences, into the fulfillment. That could be the amount of workers, technical installations, what else? Link construction, pool planning, everything of that. But if you draw that map in these three areas, or in the three levels, then you really get the feeling what depends to what. So what I want to make clear for myself was what I get through as a step, as a client through these kind of metamorphors, fulfillment of customer requirements are value creation. But customer requirements are not equal to customer value. Yeah? That's very important. I think if we get to that point that we see, I will not give an answer what in detail is a customer value, because that is always related to a different type of building and a process. But with these kind of first structure, you have the possibility to structure yourself and even make your client visualized why a goal leads to a consequence, leads to an amount of people and an attribute. So the overall conclusion we had was, for us the means and models were best for scheduling the process value in construction as well as for the product. Sometimes it helps always to have, again, these relationship models, because they show you something more in a different way. Then we use existing terminologies at just three levels. Everybody sees what is there, how they are connected, and what we are looking for is, it's the first step for ourselves in our company to make clear what do we want and what would we have to do to get that in order. Visualization clear making, simplification, reduction, and clear ways in structure helps everyone catch up things for them. Perfect. Good. Thank you.